So now we will go through the inter-process communication methods that we will not be implementing in an assignment. So the, we have the message passing. The message passing is another inter-process communication method that is implemented by the system. So the system does the two processes communicate through the system by using system calls or APIs like send and receive. The first scheme of communication is direct communication. So in direct communication, you have process P and process Q, and they just communicate. So you do send to a process ID and a message. Same for receive. Now in indirect communication, you send to a mailbox ID. So this is a process ID, this is a mailbox ID, and a message. So in this case, you have a mailbox, and you have processes P and Q. Now with the mailbox, with direct communication, a communication link will be established between a pair of processes. It can only be established between a pair of processes. Here, you can have any number of processes. So you can have process R and process S and process T. They're all communicating using this mailbox. You can even have another mailbox with processes, A, B, and P and R. So here, for each mailbox, you can have many processes. And you can have the same pair of processes, like in this case, the pair PR, communicating using multiple mailboxes. So this is the difference between direct and indirect. So in our discussion, we will care about the logical aspects of message passing, like direct, indirect, synchronous versus asynchronous, and the buffering issues. We will not worry about the physical considerations, the physical issues like how it's actually implemented. How is message passing implemented? So we only focus on the logical issue. Yeah, so direct communication, you send and receive by specifying a process ID, and the link is established automatically between a pair of processes. In indirect, you specify a mailbox, and two processes are communicating through the mailbox. So in indirect communication, the link is established only if processes share a common mailbox. A link may be associated with many processes. Each pair of processes may share several communication links, like this pair. And a link may be unidirectional or bidirectional. Another important concept when it comes to message passing is synchronization. So the communication can be synchronous or asynchronous, or blocking or non-blocking. So let's explain the difference between synchronous, async, and asynchronous. So this is blocking or synchronous. And this is non-blocking or asynchronous. With blocking, it's simpler. but it's not necessarily efficient. So the when a process does send, the process will block until that message is received. And block here means that this process will be in the waiting state. So a process sends, it will be in the waiting state, it cannot do anything until the message is received. So that's what blocking. I think the name is a very good description of what happens. Now with non-blocking, the same applies to receive. So when you receive, you block until the message is received. So if a process does receive and the message is not available yet, that process will be blocked until the message becomes available. With non-blocking, no. The sender does not have to wait, and the receiver does not have to wait. So the sender can send and then do other things. So when this send returns, that doesn't mean that the message has been delivered. With blocking, when the send returns, it means that the message has been delivered. But with non-blocking, when the send returns, that doesn't mean that the message has been delivered. But the non-blocking sender can just do other things. Now it's more interesting with the receive. So if a process does while receive or here result equals receive. Now again, when the receive returns, it does not necessarily return a valid message. So the receiver must check if result equals valid, there's an actual message, then process the message. Else, do other things. So what does it mean? It means that it can be much more efficient if the receiver has other things to do. So the receiver will keep checking on this, it will keep calling receive on a regular basis. Receive, is there a message? Is there a message? If there is no message, then the receiver can do other things, if it has other things to do. If there is a message, then the receiver will have to process that message. Okay? And this is good for servers. You know, this is something that can be useful for servers. So the server, a server process will always have other things to do if a message is not available yet. And it can be checking on, continuously checking for messages. If there's a message, it will process it. If there's no message, it has other things to do. So this is synchronous versus asynchronous. Now we can have any combination of blocking and non-blocking. There are four different combinations. Blocking, 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 non-blocking, non-blocking, blocking, and non-blocking, non-blocking. So you can have blocking send and blocking receive, or blocking send and non-blocking receive, depending on the nature of each process. Now, if both of them are blocking, then we have what we call a rendezvous, when both processes are going in lockstep. And with this kind of blocking send, blocking receive, you know, we can have a trivial solution to that. A bounded buffer problem. So here, the producer will produce one item and will do a blocking send, which means that this send will not return until the consumer receives it. So obviously, in this case, we can only produce one item, send it, and then the consumer consumes that item. After that item has been consumed, the producer will produce the next item. Okay. So obviously this will not, blocking send and receive, it's not the most efficient way of doing things. And if the producer and the consumer are going to take time in producing each item and consuming an item, then a scheme like what we are doing in assignment one, where the producer can produce multiple items while the producer is, while the consumer is working on consuming them. So in our assignment, in what we are doing in assignment one, we don't have, it's not blocking. It's both can be in parallel. The producer can be producing, working on producing items while the consumer is consuming other items. And if we have a dual core system or two CPUs, then each one of them will be running on a different CPU and both of them will be making progress. Okay, so in terms of buffering, now when the system does not offer a buffer, then we must do blocking send and receive. Because in order to do non-blocking, in order for this sender to send a message and then do other things, that message must be buffered by the system. The system must store it somewhere until it's delivered. And that's what will enable the sender to just do other things and not wait for the sender. Now, if there is a buffer and that buffer is limited, then the producer must wait when the buffer is full. When the buffer is unbounded, then the producer will never have to wait. Of course, in real systems, you know, everything is bounded. You know, strictly speaking, any computer system has infinite amount of memory, right? Infinite space. Finite space. So infinite is impossible. So unbounded, you know, is physically impossible. But if the size is sufficiently large, it will be, you know, from a practical point of view, it will be unbounded. Or it's if the amount of space that is available is much greater than the amount of data that you will be communicating, then from a practical point of view, it's unbounded. But strictly speaking, the amount of memory and the amount of all resources in the system is finite. Other methods of communication that we'd like to be aware of is, you know, sockets, for example. So sockets are endpoints for communication. So the communicating processes will create sockets and will be communicating through these sockets. Each socket is identified by an IP address and a port number. And I assume that sockets are covered in the networking class.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's why we don't focus on them here, because they're covered in the networking class. But we just want to be aware of them as inter-process communication methods. So for example, port numbers below 1,000 are well-known or standard that are used for standard services like Telnet and FTP. Address, IP address 127.0.0.1 is the loopback address. So here we just want to be aware of sockets. Remote procedure calls. The remote procedure call is an interesting concept. It's a procedure call that is actually implemented as a message across the network. So it's a process making a function call. And that function call is implemented on another machine, a server, and the system is taking these parameters of that function and marshalling them, packaging them in a way that can be transmitted over a network. So it takes the function parameters and it packages them into a message, and it sends that message over the network, and then that message is received by the server that will unpack them. So on the client side, we do the marshalling, the packaging of the parameters. On the server side, we do the unpacking and the execution and returning the results. So here's a picture that shows how this works. So I have a client and I have a server. The remote procedure calls are implemented on the server side. And for each procedure, there is a port. So,
for procedure X, procedure X is on port P, P1. Procedure Y is on port P2. So this is procedure, this is port. And procedure Z is on port P3, and so forth. Now, when an application on the client side calls the kernel, calls the system requesting or making a function call to function, say, procedure X or function X, the kernel will receive that request, but the kernel at this point doesn't know on which port is function X implemented. Now, for each function, there is a daemon on the server side that is listening on a certain port. So the client doesn't know which port. So that's why it will first send a message to the to a matchmaker on the server side. So that matchmaker is just like a lookup table. It gets a procedure name, and it looks up the corresponding port for that function name. So this matchmaker, like a table lookup, it looks up the corresponding port number, and then it returns that port number to the kernel on the client side. Now the kernel has the parameters and has the port number. With the parameters and the port number, it's going to construct a message with a port number and with the parameters packaged in a certain format that can be transmitted over the network, and then it will send them to the client side. Now there will be a daemon at that port listening to for requests, and it will take that message with the parameters packaged in it. It will unpack the message, and it will unpack the message, and it will execute the function, and it will return the results to the kernel on the client side, and then the kernel will pass them to the application. Okay, the last method of inter-process communication that we would like to cover is pipes. So there are two kinds of pipes. There are ordinary pipes and there are named pipes. So the ordinary pipes or the classical pipes work like this. So each pipe has a reading end and a writing end. And when a process calls pipe with an array of integers, an array that takes two integers, the system is going to put the address or a file descriptor for the reading side of the pipe in FD of 0 and a file descriptor for the writer side of the pipe in FD of 1. And then that's a file descriptor, which means that processes can write to and read from that pipe using the read and write system call, or the system calls that are used for reading and writing, writing to files, reading from files and writing to files. Okay, so once the process gets the file descriptors, it can treat that pipe as a file, but with the reading end and the writing end. So the file, there is a file descriptor for the reader side and a file descriptor for the writer side. And ordinary pipes can be used for communication only between a parent and a child. Now, there are more powerful pipes that are named, where a pipe has a name and it can be used for communication between any two processes that do not necessarily have to have a parent-child relation. Okay? So this is what we wanted to say about pipes. There are multiple methods. To summarize, there are multiple methods of communication, inter-process communication. We chose to focus on shared memory and implement it in experiment with it in assignment number one. Other methods of communication, we just need to know the concept and be aware of them.
aware of other methods of inter-process communication. And you know, we are assuming that message passing and sockets are covered in the networking class.